God. Glory to God. Glory to God. God is thank you. God is good. He is good. He is worthy to be praised.
Yes, He is.
I thank God. I just thank God on today because it's been a very interesting week this week for me. A lot going on within my family, and my sister had surgery, and I thank God for bringing her through, and my mother and my father got on the highway and the byway and the bad weather. I thank God for their travel and mercy. They're still on the East Coast, so I thank God for that. I thank God for bringing them home safely later this week. God has been good, you all. God has been good.
Yes, He has.
So we're going to get right into the Word of God. And the title of the message is Trouble is in My Way. But I'm not tired.
All right.
Hallelujah.
All right now.
I'm not tired.
Jesus.
See, we cannot overcome what we don't acknowledge. Trouble is in my way, but I'm not tired.
Amen.
So what do I mean by tired? First of all, we're talking about not fatigue physically. We're talking about being tired mentally, emotionally, spiritually. I heard someone talking about saying that they trust God, but questioning if they really, really trust God. See, when you have to trust the Lord, but you're teeter-tottering back and forth, if you really can trust them or not trust them, you can become very, very fatigued. So what I mean by tired, I mean exhausted, worn out, weary. Weary. So when we say we're not tired, we're saying we're not weary. We're not going to allow the situation to get the best of us. Amen? And God was speaking to me on last night about just the very, what do we have to do to overcome these troubles? And first of all, we got to get the fog out of our life.
Yes.
Yes.
We got to get the fog out of our life. We have to know who we are and what we're reaching for.
Yes.
You can look around now and see. I mean, I'm not saying that it's not a little bit out there on the roads, but I'm not the best driver.
Amen.
Okay. But I tell you what, like Pastor Rob said, some areas are clean and some areas are not. But some people just don't press.
Yes.
You know, and so if you got fog in your life where sometimes you win it and sometimes you're not, you're going to easily get fatigued. And so we have to get the fog out of our life. And what I mean by fog, let me give you the definition. Something that obscures and confuses a situation or someone's thought or process. So we have to get the confusion out of our life. We have to decide what we're actually striving for. We have to decide. When we say we're not tired, that means we're going to press on. Amen? That means we're going to do what we need to do. But we have to determine what our goals are. What are we actually here for?
Right.
What am I actually focused on?
Jesus.
You know, a lot of times people go through the motion, but they don't really have a vision. They don't really have something that they set a goal to. If you're trying to get closer to God, or you're trying to get closer to your family members, or you're trying to grow in your career, or academically, or athletically, what is your goal?
Right.
Because the enemy comes to distract you.
Yes.
The enemy comes to make you weary. The enemy comes to let maybe think you cannot make it. But if you're not even clear on where you're going.
Yes. Yes.
This is how we get confused. One day, this is our goal. And the next day, this is our goal.
Amen.
And this is just an example today that you're on your own.
Amen.
You're on your own. If you're looking for somebody else to help you during a time of trouble,
Lord Jesus,
you're going to look around and there ain't going to be nobody there.
Help us. Yes.
Amen. If we start a piece of faith because we're looking for somebody to tell us that a girl, that a boy, it's going to go stop. But I thank God that we did.
Yeah.
I thank God that we did because God told us to. And we're looking to please Him and to honor Him. You have to know what you're reaching for.
Amen.
What are your goals?
Hallelujah.
And then you have to ask God, get the confusion out of my life.
Yes.
Get the confusion out of my life so that I won't be overtaken by the enemy because I haven't made my mind up. Or it's so foggy that I can't even see where I'm going because deep down I really haven't made a decision.
All right. Amen.
And here's the thing, everything that we do, it should be unto the glory of God. Amen.
Amen.
But we all have personal goals. And if you don't have anything that's pushing you and driving you, you're not going to be motivated.
Amen.
That's why I say get the fog out your life and figure out what you're reaching for in this season.
Amen.
Figure out what you're reaching for. And it's definitely a process. The base scripture is Isaiah chapter 40. Trouble in my way, but I'm not tired. That's a very, very powerful statement. And I've been saying it for the last couple of days. I'm going to tell you, just even in my verbalizing it outwardly, I feel more powerful. I feel more steady. I feel more stable. It's something about speaking things out of your mouth.
Amen. Amen.
The base scripture is Isaiah 40, verse 31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and do not faint. So we have to realize that God, if we put our hope in the Lord, no matter what come our way, and the reason why that song was so applicable, because we will cry. You know, we will, and see, that's the thing. We have to realize that we're human beings. We will cry out. We will feel disappointment.
Yes.
That's real. We will feel like, oh my goodness, why is this happening to me? But it's not really about how we feel. It's about what we're going to do.
Yes.
So go ahead and feel what you're going to feel. Have that moment, but don't stay there. And I tell people, sometimes you just need to have a good cry.
Yeah.
It's not going fast enough. The situation is not going the way that you wanted it. You didn't have a good review on your job and you know you tried. Go ahead and cry it out. Go ahead and cry it out, because if we don't acknowledge how we really feel, it creates a fall.
Yes.
It creates a fall because we feel one way, then we say it another, then we get confused.
Uh-huh.
I tell people it's good to acknowledge what's really going on. It's very, very good to acknowledge. It takes courage to acknowledge. You know what? I'm disappointed right now.
Yeah.
I'm sad right now. I'm hurt right now. I'm X, Y, and Z right now. It's very, very therapeutic, and it's free to actually acknowledge. It's not weak. It actually takes a lot more strength to acknowledge it more than it does to admit. You know, it takes strength to admit something versus denying.
Right.
And because our strength and our hope is in the Lord. It's not in what Minister Brooks thinks of me. It's not in what my boss thinks of me. My help coming from the Lord. So if I express it and he happens to be around and he doesn't agree with it, that's really not my concern. We have to know that our help comes from the Lord. And a lot of times we don't express ourselves because we don't know how other people are going to take it. But that's really not your concern.
Right.
If you want to clear the fog, you got to clear out all the expectations of other people. That's really not your concern. What you're trying to do is get flat footed. You're trying to get in position so that you can move forward, because it is a process.
Yes, Lord.
I ran across something online the other day. It says, the first step to changing your situation is committing to the process.
Yes.
And part of the process is getting the fog out of your life, getting the confusion out of your life. Another part of the process is coming to hear the word of God.
Amen.
When you feel like it, when you don't feel like it. When it's convenient, when it's not convenient. And a lot of people haven't made their mind up that a lot of people don't do anything when it's inconvenient. When it's not convenient for them, they just don't do it. And that shows, it's a reflection in what's going on in their lives. Nothing is easy. Nothing is easy. So you have to commit, because if it was easy, you wouldn't have to commit to the process. You wouldn't have to commit to the process. It says, when you abort the process, you abort the progress. When you abort the process, you abort the progress. Meaning that when you start, and then you say, oh, this is too hard, and then you stop.
Uh-huh.
And then you start, then you stop. Then you start, then you stop. So basically, all the ground that you had made, you back to ground zero.
Yes.
That's why when we say, that's what the enemy comes to do. He comes to cycle us.
Yes.
He comes to put things in our path where we abort our process and we give up. And then we say, well, this God thing is not working. No, you're not working the God thing.
Yes.
I cannot remember when God told me things were going to be easy. But he did say he would be with me always. God never told me that things were going to be easy. But he did say he would never leave me nor forsake me. He didn't tell me that I was going to feel good every time I had to do something. But he did say the way of the Lord is perfect. So we have to know what God is saying and what God has not said.
That's right. That's
amen.
Good. That's good.
Get back on track and don't look back.
That's rich.
God can and will help you through it, but it starts within you. And I thought that was very powerful because what they're saying is when you avoid the process, I thought, wow, how many times do we start something and then we just stop? And then we find ourselves right back at ground zero. And I would have to venture to say, the next time we feel like aborting the process, let's just wait 24 hours.
That's good.
Let's just wait 24 hours. Let's cry it out. Let's pray about it. But don't make any drastic decisions. Don't say anything drastic. Don't give any type of affirmations out of your mouth. I'm done with this. I'm through with this. Don't do any of that because we don't know what God is going to do.
Amen.
And the one thing we don't want to do is keep going over the same process over and over and over and over.
Yes.
In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27, it says, do not give the devil a foothold. Do not give the devil a foothold. Do not give the devil an opportunity to come into your territory. And see, honestly, God cannot. Some of us, we're sold out for God in a sense that we believe in him, we've given our life to him, and he can't stop us, the devil can't stop us from like coming to church and things of that nature, but what he wants to do is govern your territory.
Come on,
help us. You come into church, you come out of church, you go to Bible study, you come out of Bible study, but he wants to govern your territory. He wants to rule your land, everything that's concerning you. He wants to be the one that's saying what's going to go on and what's not going to go on.
Come on.
And we do not want the devil to govern our territory.
Come on.
Remember when Jesus went to go see the man over in the grave that was cutting himself? And when those demons begged him, they said, we don't want to leave this territory.
Come on.
Please don't make us leave this territory. See, the enemy is territorial.
Yes, he is.
He's territorial.
Yeah.
And he'll keep you in a fall. You don't know what's going on. You read the word. You're like, wait a minute. Why is this not working? Because the enemy is governing your territory. Governing your territory.
That's rich.
He creates a lot of strife in your life.
Uh-huh.
He creates a lot of self-doubt. He tells you that you're not going to make it, and this not going to work, and that not going to work. And
Jesus.
He creates a lot of anxiety in you, which leads you to make quick decisions that are not well thought out.
Uh-huh. Amen.
He creates discouraging circumstances. And when you be in a fog, not really knowing if you're really determined to go for it, he creates these negative circumstances and then you just give up because you really wasn't committed in the first place.
Alright.
Because how many of us can really say that God is really, really ruling our life?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying that we're supposed to be perfect, but what we're supposed, anything that we do, we're supposed to do it to the highest of our ability.
Yes.
And you have to ask yourself, everything that I do, whether it's on my job, whether it's my parenting and my marriage, whatever it is, am I giving it my all? Am I doing the very best that I can do? I'm asking God to do something, but what am I doing?
Right. Help us.
The enemy will tell you that you will never overcome.
Mm-hmm.
The enemy will tell you that you're going to have heartache all of your life.
Jesus.
When he said, I will never leave you or forsake you, that I will lift your bowed down head. When the Bible says that I am the God that healeth thee. So if the enemy tells you, are you going to be heartbroken for the rest of your life? It doesn't add up with the word. He said, I am the God that healeth thee. That means he don't heal your broken heart.
Yes.
So when the enemy begins to tell you something that's contrary to the word, he's trying to rule your territory.
That's good.
When he begins to tell you thing after thing that doesn't line up with the word of God, he is trying to rule your territory. And if he rules your territory, he rules you.
Amen.
the will of God.
Help us.
If he in your head creating a fog, because how many of us can go to sleep, get 8 hours of sleep, and wake up tired? You're tired because you're not physically tired, you're emotionally tired. You're spiritually tired. You're fatigued because you're fighting against wicked things in high places. And this is what we don't understand. It's like, why am I tired? The enemy is trying to fight you. The enemy is resting in the atmosphere, trying to get you off your course. And if you're not completely giving it over to the devil, he's still eating at you and kicking at you and scratching at you, saying, come on, come on, give me your territory. So this is why you have to say, I'm not tired.
Yes.
Trouble is in my way, but I'm not tired.
Yeah.
I will trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not to my own understanding.
Yeah.
In all my ways, I will acknowledge him and he will direct my path. For me, blah 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 blah. But when you just hold your position,
yes.
I'm looking for you
yes.
to give me a little bit of strength.
Yes.
I'm not gonna give up.
Amen.
I'm not tired.
Yes.
And watch God.
Mm.
Before before you know it, you don't even feel like giving up anymore.
Amen. Amen.
It is very powerful to speak the word over your situation.
Yes.
If you're looking for your neighbor to speak it over you, if you're looking for your mother or your father, you have to know what you're doing and who you're doing it for.
Yes.
You have to know that God has created me in this hour to do X, Y, and Z, and I'm doing it unto his glory.
Yes.
That's why we got to get the fog out of our lives. He said, truly I tell you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. He didn't say it would be easy. He said nothing will be impossible for you.
Yes.
See, when we clear the fog, we're able to see the mountain.
Amen.
Sometimes things are going. I'm so busy. Things are going on here and there, and I feel like I'm in some type of warfare. But I'm like, okay, God, let me calm down and see what's really going on.
Uh-huh.
Where is the enemy at for real in this situation? Mm-hmm. Once you calm down and really ask God, then you can see the mountain. Then you can speak to a thing. Mm-hmm. And say, oh, no, I see what's going on over here. This is anxiety. I'm buying that up.
Yes.
That mountain will be moved.
Yes.
But when we ask God to move things out of our lives, we have to realize we have to ask God to replace them with something else.
Amen.
We've been talking about spiritual warfare in Bible study the last couple of weeks. And I have been sharing with them that once you realize that something is attacking you, that is not of God, you have to bind it up. Uh-huh. Then you have to arrest it.
Yes.
You bind it up in the name of Jesus. Yes. Then you have to curse it.
Yes.
You have to curse it in the name of Jesus and command it to wither and die.
Yes.
You bind it, then you curse it.
Yes.
Then you ask it to go and say, you have no place in my life.
Yes.
Because you have to bind it because the activity has to cease first.
Yes. Yes.
See, the activity has to cease. The warfare has to cease.
That's real.
When you're feeling overwhelmed and think you're not going to make it, say, I bind that spirit of discouragement.
Yeah.
I curse that spirit of discouragement and command it to wither and die.
Yeah.
I will not be discouraged. Discouragement is not allowed in my life.
Come on.
God, replace it with a spirit of hope.
Yeah.
And expectation.
Yes.
Because when we curse things and we command it to go, it'll come right back around looking for that spot again. But if the spot is filled,
come on,
then it can't get in your territory.
Come on here.
See, we're trying to protect our territory.
Come on here.
And your territory is everything concerning you.
Yeah.
Your territory is anybody that's concerning
come
you.
Come on here.
Every issue that you may have, every goal that you may have, that's your territory.
Yeah.
The wellness in your body is your territory. You lay hands on your body. Say, I am healed.
Yeah.
I am whole and I am delivered.
Yeah.
Spirit of infirmity, I bind you.
Yeah.
I curse you and command you to go.
Yeah.
Spirit of infirmity, you have no authority in my life.
Amen.
You must go now.
Right now.
So we have to know how to talk to the enemy.
Uh-huh.
But we have to have the faith.
Yes.
And you may say, well, I'm not a preacher, or I'm a kid. The Bible says you only need a faith as small as a mustard seed.
Right.
So before you start saying it, say, God, give me a little bit of faith.
Jesus.
So I can get this devil off my back.
Yes.
That's all you need.
Mm-hmm.
We have a couple more scriptures in 1 Corinthians 9:27. This is Paul. And I bring this scripture up to say that we're all in a battle. We are all fighting something.
Uh-huh.
And I don't want you all to think that it's just you. Everybody in this room has something that they're battling,
yes.
Including Pastor Rob, including myself, because we are on this earth in this world.
That's right.
Paul says, I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified.
Yes.
Why do I bring that up? Because be careful not to be the one saying it and not the one doing it.
Help us. Help us.
That's good.
Sometimes we get so much scripture in us and we see everybody's problems. We're so busy saying it and we're not doing it. We're so busy telling our little sister, our little brother, our neighbor, our coworker, because they don't go to church and I do. Don't be so busy saying it and not doing it that you may be disqualified.
Yeah.
That's good.
Amen.
Amen.
We have to become full aware that we in this battle just like your neighbor.
Yes.
And I also, especially like it, because he says, I train and I discipline my body as an athlete. And when you are an athlete, you build up your stamina, no matter what you're doing. I'll just say a track running. Over time, the repetition of certain things begin to build your strength up. And you do it greater, you do it quicker, and you do it faster. So I'm not sure why we don't really realize in the spirit realm why we don't have to do stuff over and over and over and over and over. If you want to be strong in the Lord, you got to read the scriptures over and over and over and over. When you want to become a better basketball player, you shoot that ball over and over. When you want to lose weight, we're going to exercise over and over and over. We're not looking for it to happen in 30 seconds. Because we know this takes time. But when we get over here in the spirit realm, then it's like, wait a minute, no, I want this to happen in 30 seconds. No, the devil is a lie. Yeah. You discipline your body.
Help us.
As an athlete.
Yeah.
You do what you need to do over and over and over. I don't care how long you've been doing it. Keep doing it because you're stronger now than you were before.
Help
us. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Athletes train between the Olympics, they train 4 years.
Yes.
They have different events and the world did a championship and all this stuff, but ultimately they train 4 years for the Olympics.
Mm-hmm.
And they have 4 years in between each Olympics, and it is a process.
Uh-huh.
And every time they compete for the Olympics, they don't know if they're going to get in.
Right.
They don't know what's going to happen.
Right.
They're just looking to do greater than they did the last time.
Uh-huh.
And so here's the thing. Don't compare yourself to other people. Just expect to do greater than you did the last time.
Yes, yes.
Don't worry about what somebody else has done or not has done. Just do better than you did the last time.
Yes.
But I want you to get the mind that you train your spirit like an athlete.
Yes.
You read the Bible over and over. Pray over and over.
Yes.
Worship over and over. Submit yourself to God over and over.
Yeah.
We forget.
Oh my God.
We gotta do this over and over and over and over and over and over.
Yeah.
Just like an athlete.
Yeah.
Because the one thing about it is we don't want to say it and not be found doing it. We get disqualified.
Yes. Help us.
We don't want to be disqualified. Sometimes we know too much and not doing enough.
Help us. Help us.
I say, God, we don't really need any more scriptures. We just need to meditate on what we already know.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
For real, for real.
Yeah.
Because we're disciplining our spirits, God. We're in America, and we want to begin to transform our thinking so that we expect to do stuff over and over.
Right.
Amen. I want you to have the expectation. You expect to read the word over and over. You expect to worship over and over. You expect to decree and declare over and over the things of your life until you get stronger.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And when you get stronger, you'll know it because you'll be able to see it. It'll manifest in your life.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
My Lord.
I have one more scripture.
This is rich.
Thank you, Lord. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, it talks about, in verse 9 and 10, it talks about obedience, and it talks about forgiving. And we have to forgive because that's what God tells us to do. But the result is in 2 and 11. It says, in order to say it, Satan might not outwit us. For we are not unaware of his schemes.
Right.
In the New Living, it says, so that Satan will not outsmart us, for we are familiar with his evil schemes.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be obedient so that we are aware of what the devil is doing.
Uh-huh.
Because you cannot fight what you're not aware of.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know how often we really, really provoke you all to say, God, show me where the enemy is in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Show me so that he will not outwit me. Show me so that I will be prepared, that I will be aware enough where I can handle the devil.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
You don't want the enemy to be more witty than you.
Right.
You don't want the devil to outwit you talking about, now Jesus don't work it out. No, 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 God, you show me through your Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
You show me where the foothold is. It says we don't want to give enemy a foothold. We don't want to give him a gap to enter in. God, you show me which way he's coming for me.
Yeah.
Show me. and then give me a strategy.
Amen.
Show me, God.
Yes.
Clean the fog out of my life. So that I will not give up. Trouble is in my way, but I'm not tired.
Amen.
Let's stand time for you.
Amen.
God is good.
Yes, it is.
God is good, and He's worthy to be praised.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
I feel good in my soul today because God is really, really giving us the strategies on how to overcome the enemy.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but I serve a God that told me that I will be the head and not the tail.
Amen.
So anytime He opens up my understanding to show me how to win, I'm glad about it.
Hallelujah.
I'm glad about it. I thank God for His word.
Yes.
I thank God for opening up our understanding on where the enemy is trying to attack us. I ask that God open up your understanding just this week to show you where the enemy is trying to enter in. And that God gives you faith as a mustard seed.
Yes.
That you will speak to that thing. Tell that mountain to move and expect it to move.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads.